Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Continuing from the tafsir of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the seerah, the biography of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we stopped at al-hijrah, the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we're looking at the lessons and examples we could take from the hijrah, the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Makkah to Medina, in terms of the strategy, planning, and execution of the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this was very important, especially for us as expats that have left one place to go to another place. That what are the strategies? What are the planning? What are the ways of executing, migrating from one place to another place? And not only for us as expats, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when it comes to the issue of hijrah, issue of migration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَا تَنْقَطِعُ الْهِجْرَةَ حَتَّى تَنْقَطِعَ التَّوْبَةَ. The hijrah, migrating from one place to another, is something that will never ever cease. Until what ceases? Repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تَنْقَطِعُ التَّوْبَةَ حَتَّى تَطْلَعَ الشَّمْسُ مِنْ مَغْرِبِهَا. And repentance will never cease until the sun rises from the west. مِنْ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. So hijrah is something which is continuous. And hijrah linguistically means what? To move from one place to another. Hijrah by sharia is to move from darul kufr, a land of kufr, to a land of al-islam. And it's something which is continuous, because there's many types of hijrah. It doesn't mean the only hijrah is Islamically to move from a place of complete kufr to a place of complete Islam. One of the types of hijrah is to move from a land of evil to a land of lesser evil. So when you move from certain communities and certain places to another place, people say, even those things you can find over there, even this is there, but it is less. So when you're making hijrah, it's not utopia, but it is better in some cases than where you're coming from. And that's why they say there's hijrah from a land of bid'ah, innovation, to a land of what? Lesser bid'ah. So when you're leaving our countries, non-Muslim countries, where evil has become rampant, to the point that some places now, you get on a train, you have that rainbow colored flag on the train this month. When you're leaving places like that to go to other Muslim countries where they have evil but it is lesser, it is still what? Hijrah. Because this is tabliis or iblis, one of the traps of shaitan that stops people leaving. That even there there's this, even there there's that, but it is lesser. It is lesser. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from his hijrah, we could learn the tactics, the planning, execution of hijrah. And other than the execution of hijrah, we said there's something else which is important, other than planning and strategy. And what is that? Al-awn min Allah, assistance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that comes in the form of what? Ad-du'a. So we mentioned last week the du'a of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered him to make when he was making hijrah, that every migrant, every expat, everyone moving from one place to the other should know this du'a. And that du'a, we said, was in Surah Al-Isra, verse number 80. And that's the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbi adkhilni madkhala sidqin wa akhrijni madkhala sidqin waj'al li min ladunka sultanan nasira. You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you an easy entry, easy exit, and for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make for you of authority, a person in position that will do what? Nasira, that will aid you. Because as we mentioned, in these parts of the world especially, and everywhere else, what is needed? What they call vitamin W, wasita. It's not what you know, it is who you know. But you don't rely on it exclusively, you ask Allah ta'ala to make for you a person who is nasira, who is in a position of authority to aid you. So we looked at the plan of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, strategy in terms of timing. He chose the right time, confidentiality, surveillance, and counter-surveillance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Who could give me an example of the surveillance method of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What did he use as surveillance? Naam, the son of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu an, who would tell, stay in Mecca, hear what they're saying, and then bring the news to me later. What was the counter-surveillance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? As Abdullah ibn Abi Bakr will come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who would be behind him? Amir ibn Fuhayra. Why would he be behind him? He will be behind him, following him with the what? The cattle, the sheep, to wipe out the footsteps of Abdullah ibn Abi Bakr. So we looked at surveillance and counter-surveillance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, we looked at how to delegate and give people duties and responsibilities. And one of the people the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, delegated was a what? Muslim? Mushrik. To show the permissibility of hiring and using a non-Muslim if he's an expert in a particular thing. And there was nobody that knew the desert better than who? Abdullah ibn Uraiqit. He was the best in knowing the desert. He took them on a route that nobody takes. So importance as a leader of delegation. Also, we looked at the sacrifices of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu in terms of his wealth, in terms of his family, and in terms of his own life for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So continuing with the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we said when the kuffar Quraysh, the mushrikeen, they realized that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had left, they put out a bounty for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this bounty was a massive bounty, 100 what? 100 camels. And the most wealthy or the most valued possession of the Arabs was what? The camels. It was like Lamborghinis, or in our context today, the Land Cruisers of their time. The Land Cruisers of their time. So imagine someone say, give you 100 Land Cruisers. If you go to Lulu, you go to Mega Mart, you find people and they do shopping, those raffles, even if it takes 20 minutes, 30 minutes, they're filling them out, hoping to win some. So imagine 100 Land Cruisers. 100 Land Cruisers. So they put out a bounty for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that whoever brings him forth, mi'ata ibal, hayyan aw mayyitan, dead or alive. It doesn't matter, dead or alive. So they all went out, different trackers, the best trackers of the desert, went out looking for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But due to the strategy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he went southward before going north, they lost the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Abu Jahl, ishta'ala ghadaban, he became more angry and more enraged by this. So he went to the different nawadi. A nadi is like a social club or social gathering of all the different Arabs to make this announcement that whoever brings Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, dead or alive, mi'ata ibn. And the hadith is narrated by Abdul Rahman ibn Malik al-Mudliji. Abdul Rahman is from the tribe of al-Mudliji, and he is the nephew of Suraaqa ibn Malik al-Ju'shum. He said that his father, and his father is who to Suraaqa? The brother of Suraaqa. Informed him that he heard Suraqa ibn Ju'shum saying, Ja'ana rusulu kuffaru Quraysh, the messengers of the kuffaru Quraysh that came to us. Meaning the news that they were spreading to look for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not within the towns and the cities. It went as far as the A'rab, the Bedouins in the deepest part of the Sahara, to all the different tribes. He said the messengers of the Quraysh that came to us, the kuffaru Quraysh. And they made for whoever a bounty finds Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, dead or alive, 100 camel. So he went on to say, that فَبَيْنَمَا أَنَا جَالِسٌ فِي مَجْلِسٍ مِنْ مَجَالِسِ قَوْمِ بَنِي مُدْلِجٍ أَقْبَلَ رَجُلٌ مِّنْهُمْ حَتَّى قَامَ عَلَيْنَا. He said, whilst I was sitting there, a man came from Bani Mudlij, meaning from his own tribe, while he was sitting there. In another narration, he said, رَجُلٌ مِنَّا, a man from amongst us, the tribe of Bani Mudlij, حَتَّى وَقَفَ عَلَيْنَا, until this person stood in front of us. And this person, when he stood in front of Bani Mudlij, and Suraqa ibn Malik was there, he said, this person, he said, وَاللَّهِ لَقَدْ رَأَيْتُ رَكَبَهْ ثَلَاثَ مَرُّوا عَلَيَّ آنِفًا, I have seen three riders going past me right now. وَإِنِّي, and verily, verily, لَأَرَاهُمْ مُحَمَّدْ وَأَصْحَابَ, and I believe that is Muhammad and his companions. So he said this after the Kuffar Quraysh announced his bounty. And Suraqa was Bani Mudlij. Suraqa ibn Nawfal said, فَأَوْلَمْتُ إِلَيْهِ أَوْ أَوْأَمْتُ إِلَيْهِ بَعَيْنِي. He said, I started to signal at him with my eyes. And uskut, shut up, be quiet, be quiet. So he said, thumma qultu, then after he kept quiet, I said, da innama hum banu fulan. It could only be such and such a tribe. Because in Arabic, when you say innama, and you find this in the Quran a lot, innama is min turiq al-hasar, to make something specific to one thing only. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, innama al-mu'minun. The believers could only be alladhina amanu billahi, those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger. Thumma lam yartabu, and after that they have no doubt. So anyone other than that is not a what? Is not a believer. Or the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهِ. The only people that fear Allah based on knowledge is who? Al-ulama. So the word إِنَّمَا, it affirms that which is being mentioned and negates everything else. And that's why they say inna, it stands for authority. And ma is what? Negation. So here Suraaqa said, innama, it could only be Banu Fulan, nobody else. It could only be such and such a tribe. يَبْتَغُونَ ضَالَ لَهُمْ. They're looking for a lost camel of theirs. That's the only people it could be. It could not be Muhammad and his companions. So when he said to the people, Suraaqa, to show a lack of eagerness for who they are, Suraaqa ibn Malik, he said, after I said this to them, that I sat there for a while. I sat there. ثُمَّ مَكَثْتُ قَلِيلًا. I'm not in a hurry. I'm not looking for them. ثُمَّ مَكَثْتُ قَلِيلًا. ثُمَّ قُلْتُمْ فَدَخَلْتُ بَيْتِي. He said, after I sat there for a while, they realized that, you know what, it's not a hurry to go anywhere. He said, I sat for a while, then I entered my house. And I ordered my female slave to prepare for me my horse. So he knew for certain it was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companion. And Suraaqa ibn Malik, in preparing himself, Suraaqa ibn Malik said, I prepared for my horse to be prepared for me. And he said, and that horse was brought to me in the middle of the valleys. And I left my house min duburu hujrati. And I prepared also, for my weapons to be brought for me from behind the house, not from the front of the house. In the same way that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and the Prophet left from the back, he left from the back. ثُمَّ أَخَذْتُ قِدَاحِي الَّتِي أَسْتَقْسِمْ بِهَا. And then the last thing, which is very important for the mushrikeen of those days, the last thing he took with him was al-qidah or al-azlam, which is like, in the modern day version, we call it the tarot cards or the Ouija board, that they use it to ask the gods to predict the future, whether they should do something or not do something. And usually it'll be written in it, if'al, la taf'al, do, do not do. And the one Suraaqa he had, it was harm them, do not harm them. So he said, I took this with me. That's very important for them on their journey. Sometimes they will not go on a journey at all. If he says, la taf'al, they will not go on the journey. So he said, I took this with me, qidahi. And he said, falabastu la'mati. After that, I dressed myself in the war vest, meaning all the armor that he needed was with him. His sword, his dagger, to protect himself from injury, the vest which they wear, the armor, and the spear. He said, I took everything with me. So he was going to kill the Prophet ﷺ or bring him as a prisoner. Now, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he said, I wore this and I went out. I continued. He said, but before I left, I threw the, qidah, to see what he told me to do. He said, when I threw my qidah, he says, he showed me, فَخَرَجَ السَّهَمْ الَّذِي أَكْرَى. He showed me that which I did not want. And that was what? لَا يَضُرُّهُ. You should not harm him. Meaning, do not proceed. He said, قَالْ, but I was أَرْجُو أَنْ أَرُدَّهُ عَلَى قُرَيْشِ فَآخُذْ مِئَةَ نَاقَى. He said, but I was still hoping I would want to get that 100 camels. Return him and get the 100 camels. Return Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam Bakr. So he said, فَعَصَيْتُ. I disobeyed the Islam. I disobeyed the qidah. Whatever the prediction was, I disobeyed it. So I continued. So he said, I continued with my riding animals and riding with it fast. He said, I continued hatta athara bi fasaqattu anhu. Until all of a sudden, he did something he never done before. He stumbled and I fell off the horse. At that point, what did he retreat to immediately? It's qidah. He threw it again, like a dice. And he said to him, do not proceed. He said, no, I'm disobeying the 100 camels. He got back on top of his horse and he started to ride. He said a second time, he stumbled and I fell off it. And what did he do again? The qidah. La tadurru, la yadurru. Do not proceed. And he proceeded. He said he proceeded until he came close and he could see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, at this point, when I started to see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, my horse is stumbled again. And he said, at this point, when he stumbled again, thumma, the horse, ذهبت يداه في الأرض. The hands of the horse is sunk into the earth completely. And the hands here means the front part of it. It sank into the earth completely. He said, I pulled it up. And I was harsh with the horse. When I pulled it up, And the legs of the horse, or the front part, came out. It came out bidukhan, with a smoke. كَأَنَّهُ صَاطِعْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ Or though it was from the heavens. Said the smoke, or i'sar, or like a tornado. When he pulled out the horse's leg, it was a tornado. So now I couldn't see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In another narration, he said, Suraaqa ibn Malik. He claimed so close, he came so close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, تَقَرَّبَ حَتَّى سَمِعَ or حَتَّى سِمِعْتُ Until I could hear qira'ah Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was so close, he could hear the recitation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَهُوَ لَا يَلْتَفِتْ He said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was reciting. And although he knew there was somebody pursuing them, لَا يَلْتَفِتْ He didn't turn left or right, he just continued to recite. He said, as for Abu Bakr radiallahu an, yukthiru iltifat. He was turning around constantly. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not turn. He said he came so close. And at that point, when the horse, his foot sank to the ground, it sank to the ground to the point that it was sunk to its knees, all the way to the knees. And when the smoke came up, Suraaqa ibn Malik, he said at that point, waqa'a fi nafsi. It became apparent to me. حِينَ لَقِيتُ مَا لَقِيتُ مِنَ الْحَبْسِ عَنْهُمْ It became apparent to me when I was prevented from reaching them. أَنْ سَيَظْهَرُ أَمْرُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ He said it became apparent to me at that point that the affair that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم has come with is going to be victorious. No doubt about it. At that point, he started to shout out to them that allow me to see you. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Abu Bakr, ask him what he wants. Suraqa, he said, no harm will come to you from me. Just allow me to come to you. When they permitted him to come, Suraqa ibn Malik, he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam something amazing. Bi amanin, for security and protection. So now, from being the hunter to being the what? The hunted, he said, Uridu aman, I want from you security. What security does he want from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He's being chased, he's on the run. Or Suraqa ibn Malik could just turn around and go back. Why does he need protection from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He said he wants from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam al-aman. He wanted from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam al-aman, security. What security does he need from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at this point? What do you think is the security he needed from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What security? No, based on what he mentioned previously, which is what? He knew for certain the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to be victorious. It wasn't security for now or tomorrow or the next month or the next year, security for the future. He knew a time will come that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going to be victorious. So the aman he wanted from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not for now. He said, I want al-aman. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered Abdullah ibn Urayqit to write down for him on a piece of leather or parchment, aman, a guarantee of protection or security to Suraqa. And he wrote it down on that parchment, on that piece of leather. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he started to inform me that your people are looking for you. And he offered food and everything to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he refused. So he said, what do you want me to do? He asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what do you want me to do? He said, stop following our trail. وَأَخِفْ عَنَّا Hide our trails. Do not follow us anymore. So Suraqa ibn Malik al-Ju'sham, he did not follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he went back. And he took with him that piece of al-aman, that piece of leather. Now Suraqa, in another narration, Ibn Malik, when he pursued the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ibn Abd al-Barr and also Ibn Hajar in the narration said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to Suraqa, كَيْفَ بِكَ إِذَا لَبِسْتَ Why would it be when you wear the bracelets of Kisra? And Suraqa ibn Nawfal was shocked. Because what is Kisra? This was the empire or the emperor of who? The Persians. That he had to ask, the bracelets of who? Kisra. Because those emperors used to wear a lot of jewelries. Like the bracelet of Kisra. This is a man on the run. He has two people with him. And he's promising me the bracelet of the Persian or the emperor of Persia. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Suraqa this question. And Suraqa, that piece of leather which he kept, Suraqa, he went on to mention that piece of leather, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as he felt will be victorious in his affair. He said, this piece of paper that the Prophet ﷺ wrote on, or the piece of leather or parchment, he said, فَأَخَطْتُهُ فَأَجَعَلْتُهُ, I took it and I put it in my pouch. ثُمَّ رَجَعْتُهُ فَسَكَتْتُ فَلَمْ أَذْكُرْ شَيْئًا مِمَّا كَانَ, I went back to my people, I didn't mention anything at all what I'd witnessed from the Prophet ﷺ. He said the Prophet ﷺ completed the hijrah. Then what happened, he said, and what happened after that was فَتْحُ مَكَّةِ, the conquest of what? The conquest of Makkah happened. He said, after the conquest of Mecca was Hunayn wa Ta'if, the conquest of Hunayn and Ta'if. This is many years later. So Suraaqa said, فَخَرَجْتُ مَعِيَ كِتَاب لِأَلْقَاهُ. He said, when I heard about the conquest of Ta'if and Hunayn, he said, I went out with this parchment or this piece of leather or bone that the Prophet ﷺ wrote the Iman on to meet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَلَقِيتُهُ, he said, I met the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when I met him, surrounding him was the Ansar and the Muhajireen. He said, فَدَخَلْتُ فَكَتِيبَ مِنْ خَيْلِ الْأَنصَارِ, I entered to the camps of the Ansar. He said, when I entered, فَجَعَلُوا يَقْرَعُونَنِي بِالرِّمَاحِ يَقُولُونَ إِلَيْكَ إِلَيْكَ. Subhanallah, to show how much the Ansar, their love and the protection of Prophet ﷺ, when they saw Suraqa, this tracker, this mushrik coming, he said, they started to poke me with their arrows, not to go near the Prophet ﷺ. Poking with the arrows, move back, move back, move back. In the same way you see modern bodyguards today, modern bodyguards to push people back. And we spoke about bullet catchers. Example, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, how he protected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he stuck his foot in the hole of the cave. Such were the Sahaba and the protection of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They didn't allow him to go near the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were pushing him back with the arrows. And even when you look at the conquest of Mecca, the way the Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered, they were fully in full armor, fully loaded. That some of them said, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was entering Mecca with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, that Abu Sufyan would be asking one of the companions, there was a mushrik at that time, who is this? Because he couldn't recognize their faces. They were fully covered from head to toe. Fully covered from head to toe. Some of them said they could only recognize the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from one thing. And that's based on the description of who? Ummu Ma'bad. And that's why that story of Ummu Ma'bad was important, which we did last week. Because it's the most detailed, in-depth description of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The hadith of Ummu Ma'bad. Even though other Sahaba could have described the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ali ibn Abi Talib, because his children looked like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he's a cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Ummu Ma'bad's description was the best description of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And other than Ali, there was Sahaba. Because the Sahaba is a person that met or saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But why is it they could have described the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as Ummu Ma'bad described him? Why? Why do you think that is? One of the reasons they say, like a Sahabi radiallahu anhu, he said, ma mala'a 'ayni min Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I never got a complete picture or looked at the Prophet completely, out of shyness and reverence. You know, when you respect somebody, you hold them in high regard, it's very difficult to look at them. So the Sahabi radiallahu anhu, they could never look at the Prophet completely. So when the Prophet entered Mecca, they say we could only recognize him for one thing. They say, min sawadi 'ayni, from the blackness of his eyes. He was covered, they could only see the blackness of that eye. Because in the description of Mu'abad, the blackness of his eyes was what? Extremely black. So they were poking him, they were poking him with their arrows. Ilayka, ilayka. So he said, when he entered, and they were poking him with their spears, sorry, not the arrows, saying, move back, move back. فَدَنَوْتُ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ, he said, I drew close, I was insistent. I drew close to the Prophet ﷺ, وَهُوَ عَلَى نَاقَتِهِ. And he said, Wallahi, كَأَنِّي أَنْظُرْ إِلَىٰ سَاقِهِ فِي غَرْزِهِ كَأَنَّهَا جُمَارَةٌ. He said, when I drew close to the Prophet ﷺ, he said, I noticed his saq, his shin, in that part of where you put your foot by the camel. He said, I saw the shin of the Prophet ﷺ, كَأَنَّهَا جُمَارَةٌ. He said, the shin of the Prophet ﷺ was like the inner part of the trunk or the date tree. The trunk of the date tree. When you split it open, what is it? White. Due to the whiteness of the shin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, فَرَفَعْتُ يَدَيَّ بِالْكِتَابِ ثُمَّ قُلْتُ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ هَذَا كِتَابُكَ لِي أَنَا سُرَاقَ إِبْنُ جُعْشُمْ. He said, this is the book that time you wrote for me. Guarantee of protection that you wrote for me on this piece of leather or this piece of bone. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. He said, at that point, the Prophet ﷺ said, الْيَوْمُ يَوْمُ الْوَفَاءِ وَالْبِرُّ. Today is a day of fulfillment of promise and righteous deed. So he gave it to the Prophet ﷺ. He said, at that point, I accepted Islam. He said, فَأَسْلَمْتُ ثُمَّ تَذَكَّرْتُ شَيْئًا أَسْأَلْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. He said, at that point, something came to my mind. I remembered I always wanted to ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what do you think? Now you've met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you accepted Islam. What would be on your mind to ask him? He said, there's something I wanted to ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, Ya Rasulullah, al-dalah min al-ibl taghsha hayadi. He said, there's a camel which is lost, and it comes to the fountain which I give water to my what? My own camels. Jayid. I said, and this fountain which my camels drink from, malatuha li'ibli. I've only filled it up for who? My camels. But this lost camel, he comes there and drinks from it all the time. Halli min ajri min an asqiha. Is there any reward for me at all? Every time this lost camel, it drinks, or I give it water from my fountain. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, na'am fi kulli dhati kabdin hur. Ajar, every single liver which you moisten, you get a reward for it. And that's why you find in the masajid, people distribute what a lot? Water. That's why you find some people, the water that drops out from the AC in the back, they put it in a small bowl, especially in this weather for who? The cats, the stray cats, to show, subhanAllah, the emphasis of the sunnah when it comes to looking after animals. And nowadays, especially in the summertime we're in, you're going to notice a lot of stray cats. Why? People go on holiday, they throw the cats out. So this is what he wanted to ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this part here, it teaches the importance of looking after animals, generally. So he said, I asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam this question. Ashu Suraqa, after accepting al-Islam, it was said in the time of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that when they had conquered, and they taken the treasures of the Persians. That in time of Umar radiallahu an, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Suraqa prior to, كَيْفَ بِكَ إِذَا لَبَسْتَ. How would it be when you wear the bracelets of Kisra? He said, and then when Umar radiallahu an, he captured to the treasures of Kisra, he called Suraqa. وَكَانَ سُرَاقَ كَثِيرُ الشَّعَرِ. He had a lot of hair. And he said, Umar radiallahu anhu, he put upon Suraqa's head the crown of Kisra on his head. And when he put the crown of Kisra upon his head, Umar radiallahu anhu, he also put on Suraqa the what? The bracelet of Kisra. And at that point, the Muslims, because that story became widespread amongst the Muslims, the place started to echo, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. To show from the sunnah, عند الفرح, at a time of happiness, what to say is what? Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And then Umar radiallahu an began to say, Alhamdulillah alladhi, all praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who seized it from Kisra, alladhi kana yaqul ana rabbun nas. The one that used to say, I am the Lord of mankind. And made Suraqa ibn Malik Ju'shum A'rabi min Bani Mudlij. Subhanallah, made Suraqa ibn Malik ibn Ju'shum a desert Arab wear the bracelet and the taj of Kisra. And after that, they took him around the Medina. And that was the slogan on that day. Around Medina, they put him on a horse with the crown of Kisra, the bracelet of Kisra, and they say, Alhamdulillah alladhi سلبها كسرى ابن هرمز وألبسها سراقة ابن جعشم أعربيا من بني مدلج. So سراقة accepted Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he continued upon his journey. And when the Ansar, they heard about the coming of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were preparing for the entrance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They say, we used to go to the outskirts just to hear the Prophet was coming. Ask us of Medina every day, waiting for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and nothing would cause us to go back in our houses except the excessive heat of the sun. Waqtu dhahira. So next week, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, we're going to look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he reaches a Quba, how the Ansar, they welcome the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also next week and the week after, the lessons we could take from Hijrah. And the reason I mention this is, I hope some of the brothers will be taking notes. And if you haven't been, at least try to watch the video online. Why? Because next week and the week after, not myself only, but even yourself, we're going to look at the lessons based on these things we learn from Hijrah, the different lesson we could extract from the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Where's the incident of Ma'bad? Whether it's about hiring a non-Muslim to do your work? Whether it's the incident of Suraaqa, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changes us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changes situations. From the lesson of this Hijrah alone, it was about 31 lessons only from this Hijrah. 31 different lessons, amazing lessons. So inshallah, next week we look at how the Ansar, they welcomed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he reached Quba, when he reached Medina, and also the lesson from the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanakallahu bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Any questions inshallah?